No better word than from your lips. No perfect life than what you lived. No greater gift, no, not one. No brighter star has ever shined. No better hope for all mankind. No higher mind. No, no, not one. No one has ever known this kind of love you've shown. That greater love than your son. No, not one. And there will never be a greater love. No, not one. With this life you have forgiven us, hope has come, hope has come. And there will never be a greater love. No, not one. No. No image true or sweet or frame. No simple word can match him. No greater fame. No, not one. No one has ever seen the depth of your majesty. There has never been a greater love than your son. No, not one. And there will never be a greater love. No, not one. With this life you have forgiven us, hope has come, hope has come. And there will never be a greater love. No, not one.
Oh, we'll do that after the break. Okay. Good morning, everyone. Welcome, everyone, to worship at St. Jacob's Stone Church. A special shout out of thanks to the tech team who have actually moved us indoors and have set up slides for us and battling with a couple of electrical glitches, but we're working through all that. And welcome to all those listening. If you're in a care home, or and we have people in the hospital listening and people at home listening. You know, what's wonderful is that we are all brothers and sisters in Christ, and we are all united through all this beautiful with and with the technicians who can help us use that technology. Prepare for worship as we listen to the Pray, Lord.
We've lost power a couple times so far this morning, so we'll be back.
Thank you. Let us begin with this reassurance from the Apostle Paul. For I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love.
Death can't and life can't. The angels won't, and all the powers of hell itself cannot keep God's love away.
Our fears for today, our worries about tomorrow,
or where we are, high above the sky or in the deepest ocean.
Nothing will ever be able to separate us from the love of God demonstrated by our Lord Jesus Christ when he died for us.
Let us gather and rejoice in the infinite and steadfast love of our God.
To me, I need to tell you to pull out your hymnals. Sorry. Your celebration hymnal, page 29, Begin My Tongue, Some Heavenly Theme. We're going to use our celebration hymnals today.
Some heavenly theme and speak some boundless thing. The mighty soar, mightier name of our eternal King. Tell of his wondrous fullness and sound his power abroad. Sing the sweet promise of his grace, the love and truth. His very word of grace strong as that which built the skies. The voice that rules the stars along speaks all the promises. Oh, might I hear thy heavenly tongue but whisper, thou art mine. Those gentle shall raise my song to notes almost divine.
Please be seated.
This morning, we pray for Karen and Robert Anstein, Farsh, Tim Mathias, Pastor Bruce, who is at Wellspan, Ray Henry, who is at Wellspan. He'll be having a procedure done today. Wellspan as well, having a procedure done. And Jerry Hsu Jr. And we pray for the friends and family of Allison Bliss, Suella Kadri, Hazel Callis, and Dolores Dotson.
All right, will you all please come with me and join in prayer? Wonderful Creator God, you gave us the rain last night, which we so desperately needed. I may have prayed too hard because there was a lot of rain last. Farmers, it is a true blessing, not just an inconvenience. And so we thank you for the sunshine and for the rain and for your eternal loving care. We ask you to please be with all those on our various prayer lists and to be with those who are listening at home, whether they are in a care home or in their own hospital, because we know that your abiding presence is with all of us. Lord, we come today with much on our hearts, and we know that some of our prayers we don't even know how to pray. But you tell us that the Holy Spirit will intercede for us, and that He and you and Jesus are there for us. So we bring you now in a brief moment of silence our personal concerns and cares. And Lord, we bring you our gratitude. We have so many blessings that we couldn't possibly have them all. With a home and a family and pets and beautiful location in central Pennsylvania, and blessed to be part of this congregation as we worship as brothers and sisters in Christ. And so, Lord, we continue to thank you for all that you have done for us. Appeal to you to be with us in our trials and our sorrows, and we pray together that our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Your offerings can be mailed to Cindy Forbes at 5123 Sinsheim School Road, Spring Grove, Pennsylvania, 17362. And your Sunday school offering can be sent to Neil Warball at 800 Mangus Mills Road, Spring Grove, Pennsylvania, 17362. And for those of us joining us today, church envelopes and offering plates for both Sunday school and church are at the back of the sanctuary.
Join with me in prayer. Lord, we know that they asked us to look at a coin and ask whose it was, Caesar's or the Lord's. And Jesus said, give unto the Lord what is Lord and give unto Caesar. And so we come today giving you our time, our talents, our use us, Lord. Make us an offering. Help us to spread the gospel, be kind to each other, and be the people that you have created us to be. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Patty speaking to write poetry. So usually when I'm up here leading worship, you're going to hear a poem. And the poem today is called, No Bother. And you probably noticed that the theme today is about not being bothered by things. So that's what we're going to work on. And the poem comes from Mark 5, 35. They ask him, why bother the teacher any longer? So much in life may seem frustrating, We lose our patience too. Irritations can be grating. So what are we to do? If we use this lead, we'd see that understanding will give us patience that we need, prevent us from demanding. Our precious Savior never halted from loving, touching, healing, nor troubled souls and suffering faulted, just God's firm love revealing. As we have been forgiven, blessed, and offered grace unbounded, let us extend to all the rest the same sweet grace, feeling bothered, vexed, the words of sacred text and angry judgment quell. Christ showed us how to love and live. We're children of the Father. And in Christ's name, let service give. Love never is a bother.
Mindy and I have some special music to share. It's entitled, You Never Let
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storm, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no God is with me, and if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh, no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh, no, you never let go. In every high and every, oh no, you never let go, Lord.
And I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on,
a glorious light beyond all.
These troubles until that day comes, we'll live to know you here on the earth,
and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me, and if my God is with me, whom then shall I? Shall I fear? Oh, no, go through the calm and through the storm. Oh, no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh, no, you never, Lord, you never let go of me. You keep on running and you never let go. Singing, oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh, oh no, you never let go in every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Yes, I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to this, but until that day comes, still I will praise you. Still I will praise you. Yes, I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. And there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you. Still I will praise you. Storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Lord, you never let go of me.
Thank you, Mindy and Jonas, for that inspiring witness and testimony and blessing. Thank you. Okay, it's time now for the children's story. So I would like them to come forward if they will. I have some new. Hello. Good morning. Room for everybody? Okay. How's everybody this morning? We're good. Let's tell the people at home who's here. So why don't you tell everyone your name?
Alaria. Maggie. Axel.
Okay. So we've got four beautiful children and somebody that I'm waving to back there. And that's all good. Okay, Noah. That works. I brought something to show you today, and I want you to see what you think of it. Getting out. Who is this? It's a teddy bear. Do you know which teddy bear it is? He's very old. He's 43 years old.
I'm surprised he still looks really good.
Well, I'm glad you think he looks well. He belongs to my son, Ryan, and Ryan is now 43. This is Winnie the Pooh.
Well, hi, Winnie.
Does it look like the Winnie the Pooh? What's he missing? His shirt. He's a little beat up, but you know what that means?
He's missing his bowl of honey.
We'll get to this. This means he was well loved. My mother's Bible was really beat up. Do you know what looked very used? Exactly. She used it a lot. She used it every day. Can he sit here with you? Thank you. I know he appreciates that. I collect children's books. I think children's books have a lot of wisdom in them, don't you think? So here's Winnie the Pooh. And everybody knows that Winnie is famous for saying one word, or two words, really.
Oh, bother.
Yep. Oh, bother. So why did I bother to save this bear for 43 years, do you think?
Probably because he holds a lot of memories in him. Say that again. Probably because he holds a lot of memories in him.
He holds a lot of memories. It's important to me. And I think that Winnie the Pooh is pretty smart. He says a lot of cool things. In this book, if you look, everybody's sad because it's snowing and they didn't quite know what to do. And when Winnie gets a little upset, he says, oh, bother. So he said, oh, bother. The end of the book, because Winnie the Pooh was kind and positive and listened to Christopher Robin, now they're having fun, and they're happy. Because Winnie the Pooh always taught us to be kind. Why is it so important to be kind? What happens when you're mean?
People's feelings get hurt.
Feelings get hurt. Have you ever had your feelings hurt because somebody said something that might not have been kind? Mine too. I want to share one more thing with you. And I need a little help. Who wants to hold this wax paper out? Can we do that as a team? Can you see it okay, Axel? Okay. Now, that's a piece of wax paper. I want you to hold it flat. Hold it flat. The other way. I'm sorry. I'm giving you bad directions. We're like it's on a table. You got it? Thank you, Elijah. You got it. Okay. I have a tube of toothpaste. A tube of toothpaste is like the words we use. If we use unkind words, get them out of the tube of toothpaste. I want you to think you're sorry you said those words. Can we put that back in? Back in. It would take a long time, and it would be very messy. Does it smell good? You don't like that flavor of toothpaste. The point is, when you say, and so we don't want to let those unkind words out, and that's what Winnie the Pooh tells us, always to be kind. Now, Maggie, you mentioned honey, because Winnie the Pooh likes his honey, right? It's very sweet.
This little ceramic like bowl, it's kind of like a big planter, and there's little bees in it, and then like yellow honey.
Full of sweet honey, because we are to be kind. So I want you each to take a couple stickers, and the stickers say be kind with two bees, so we can have a couple. I have plenty of stickers. You can each have two. You can pass them down. Things. Does that make sense? All right. Wonderful. That sounds great. Thank you. That was really sweet of you, Maggie. That was kind of you. Can we all say a prayer together? Dear Jesus, thank you for all you give us. Help us to be kind and help us to bother with other people. Amen. Thank you so much for coming up. I appreciate it. Bye. Can you get them all there? You got them? Good.
748 in your celebration hymnal. Gracious Spirit from above, thou hast taught me it is so. Oh, this full and perfect peace, oh, this transport all divine, in a love which cannot cease, I am his and he is mine. In a love which cannot cease, I am his and he is mine.
mine. Heaven above is softer blue, earth around is sweeter green. Something lives in every hue Christless eyes have never seen. Birds with gladder songs o'erflow, flowers with deep beauty shine. Since I know, as now I know, I am His, He is mine. I know, as now I know, I am His and He is mine. Things that once were wild alarms cannot now disturb my rest. Closed in everlasting arms, pillowed on the loving breast. Oh, to lie forever here, doubt and care and self resign, while He whispers in my ear, I am His and He is mine. While He whispers in my ear, I am His and He is mine. His forever, only His, who the Lord and me shall part. Ah, with what a rest of bliss Christ can fill the loving heart. Heaven and earth may fade and flee, firstborn light in gloom decline, but while God and I shall be, I am His and He is mine. But while God and I shall be, I am His and He is mine.
From Psalm 130, from the depth of my despair, I call to You, Lord. Hear my cry, O Lord. Listen to my call for help. If You kept a record of our sins, who could escape being condemned? But You forgive us so that we should stand in awe of You. I wait eagerly for the Lord's help, and in His word I trust. I wait for the Lord more eagerly than centuries wait for the dawn. Israel, trust in the Lord, because His love is constant. He is always willing to save. He will save His people, Israel, from sins. Jesus took across the other side of the lake. There at the lakeside, a large crowd gathered around Him. Jairus, an official of the local synagogue, arrived. And when he saw Jesus, he threw himself down at His feet and begged Him earnestly, "My daughter is very sick. Please come and place Your hands on her so that she will get well and live." Jesus started off with him. So many people were going along with Jesus that they were crowding from terribly from some severe bleeding for 12 years. Even though she had been treated by many doctors, She had spent all her money, but instead of getting better, she got worse all of the time. She had heard about Jesus, so she came in the crowd behind him, saying to herself, "If I just touch those, I will get well." She touched his cloak, and her bleeding stopped at once, and she inside herself that she was healed of her trouble. At once knew the power had gone out of him. So he turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" His disciples answered him, "You see how many people are crowding you. Why do you ask who touched you?" But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. The woman realized what had happened to her, so she came trembling with fear, knelt at his feet, and told him the whole truth. Jesus said to her, "My daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your trouble." While Jesus was saying this, some messengers came from Jairus' house and told him, "Your daughter has died. Why bother the teacher any longer?" Jesus paid no attention to what they had to leave. Then he did not let anyone else go on with him except Peter, James, and his brother John. They arrived at Jairus' house, where Jesus saw the confusion and heard all the loud crying and wailing. He went in and said to them, "Why all this confusion? Why are you crying? The child is not dead. She is only sleeping." They started making fun of him, so he put them all out, took the child's father and mother and the three disciples, and went into the room where the child was laying. He took her by the hand and said, "Talita kum," which means, "Little girl, I tell you to get up." She got up at once and started walking around. She was 12 years old. When this happened, they were completely amazed.
Thank you, Chad. Will you join me in prayer? Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, and may they empower us to do your work and spread your gospel. In Jesus' name, amen. Maybe some of you have been here too. One day I was at the grocery store. I was in a hurry, and I selfishly just wanted to get home after work and get dinner started. So I grabbed a pack of hamburger rolls I needed for dinner, and I went to the express line. The sign clearly said 12 items or less, but the woman in front of me had a cart that was nearly half full. I really was bothered by what I thought was her thoughtlessness. If I think about it, I have a really silly and selfish things that bother me. Some with you this morning. I'm by the fact that gas tank openings aren't the same on all vehicles. And when I pull into a gas station, I never know which way to go, how to get in there, how to scrooge in and get my gas tank filled, okay? I'm bothered when somebody tells me the ending of a book or a movie that I haven't seen or finished yet. And I'm really bothered when I'm late and the car in front of me is going 5 miles under the speed limit. Now, the word bother is kind of an interesting word, isn't it? We have lots of expressions like, "I can't be bothered with that," or "that's no bother," or "I hate to bother you." And as the children learned this morning, Winnie the Pooh say, "Oh, bother." Bother means to annoy, especially with petty little things or irritations. Sometimes it can mean to pester somebody. Friends, don't bother him when he's working. Of course, bother can also mean to cause someone that's anxious or concerned. For instance, my stomach is bothering me right now because I'm a little nervous up here, all right? Of course, as the children and I shared with you, bother can be a sticky situation with or without honey, okay? But life can be much sweeter. It can be wonderful if we think about the word bother the way Jesus thinks about the word bother. Now think about today's scripture. Can you imagine Jesus and his disciples navigating through those crowds in our scripture today? Jesus had just healed the man possessed by demons who had been living among the tombs and had been in chains, and he had been abandoned by everyone. Jesus was bothered enough to heal that man, but then Jesus and his disciples go back to the western side of Lake Galilee. They were told many people wanted to see him, and so a crowd formed around him. An official from the local synagogue, Jairus, makes his way to Jesus. Now, I imagine because Jairus was important and his dress, and he probably had other officials with him, can you picture it? Probably parted a little bit for Jairus. And he asked Jesus to come heal his daughter who is very sick. Now, why would Jesus bother to do that? He had all these other people who were seeking after him, and the synagogue officials hadn't been very friendly with him, to say the least. They challenged him at every opportunity. They questioned his authority. And in some cases, we know they were colluding with the Roman authorities. John the Baptist, Jesus' cousin, would soon be beheaded, and danger was everywhere. But Jesus never hesitates. Mark tells us that Jesus started off immediately with Jairus as the people followed, crowding Jesus on every side. But as Jesus passes through the crowd with Jairus and his disciples, a woman touches Jesus' robes. Mark tells us that this woman had been bleeding for 12 years. That illness that she had wasn't just a physical ordeal for her, but it was social and spiritual too. She would have been considered unclean, and that would have meant she couldn't participate in Jewish religious ceremonies at the temple. Gail shared this morning that Paul in his travels would have been unclean with the people that he witnessed to. So she was excluded from worship and community life. She probably wasn't able to eat at the table with her friends and family, maybe not even draw water from the well with the other women of her village. She would have been isolated and alone because nobody would bother with her. When I had my first baby, I lived up Upper Adams County in the Orchard, moved to Shippensburg. It was beautiful and it was lonely. I didn't have any close neighbors. My mother was an hour away, and at the time I just moved there and had joined a church but didn't really know anybody. I knew what it felt like to be alone and scared with a newborn baby. It wasn't always cooperating, even if he had Winnie the Pooh, all right? Many of you probably understand that too. And that's why I personally am so touched by the ministry here at Stone Church. Your phone ministry, the visitation ministry, the multiple ways of allowing people to join worship on a Sunday morning and to phone in for Sunday school on a Sunday morning. People are not alone because you bother. You care about each other. You help prevent others from feeling isolated and alone, alive and strong. But the woman, even though she was unhealthy and isolated, she had a faith that was unbelievable. She believed that if she simply touched Jesus' cloak, she would be healed. She didn't want to bother him. She just wanted her life back. By law, her touch would have made Jesus unclean as well. But she did it anyway. She went up and she touched him and she was cured immediately. And she knew that immediately too. But so did Jesus. Mark tells us she touched his cloak and her bleeding stopped at once. And she had the feeling inside herself that she was healed of her trouble. At once, Jesus knew that power had gone out of him, so he turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" Well, how could he possibly know that? He was being pushed and jostled on every side by this crowd. You know what it's like when you're trying to make your way through a crowd. You don't know who's touching you or what it is. How could he have been aware of one specific touch amid all that pushing and touching? But Jesus kept looking around to see who had touched him, who had bothered him. The woman realized she was guilty, so she came trembling with fear and knelt at his feet and told him the truth. Can you imagine how her heart must have been pounding? She, in a sense, had just stolen a miracle. She was a thief. Would she be punished? Would her newly acquired acceptance be so short-lived? But Jesus said to her, "My daughter, your faith has made you well. Go and be healed of your trouble." Jesus was not bothered by this woman. He did not mind that she had touched his robe. In fact, more than not being bothered by her, he rewarded her with healing and he called her daughter. He had restored her physically and spiritually. She was no longer alone, no longer isolated or banned from the community. She was a child of God, a daughter. But the scripture in Mark doesn't end with the healing of this brave, faith-filled woman, because while Jesus was saying that, messengers came from Jairus' house and said, "Your daughter has died. Why bother the teacher any longer?" Well, Jesus wanted to be bothered. He wanted to go to Jairus' home to see Jairus' daughter. "She's not dead," Jesus said. He goes to the house and tells her to get up. Mark tells us she got up at once and started walking around. Everyone, of course, was completely amazed. I think we're often completely amazed, and perhaps that amazement shows more of our doubt than our faith. A friend of mine once said to me, "Why are we always so astounded when God cares about us, hurts us, and bothers with us? After all, God is God. Jesus is Jesus, and well, the Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit. Why do we question their power, their support, their steadfastness, their total commitment to bothering with us?" Psalm 8 asks this question: "When I look at the sky, which you have made, at the moon and the stars, which you set in their places, what are human beings that you think of them, mere mortals that you care for them?" In other words, the psalmist wants to know, "God, why are you bothering with us? Why does God bother with us? Why did he must have known that we were going to sin and turn against him?" You know, Billy Graham, one of my favorite people, once said, "God created us for one reason, to know him and love him and have fellowship with him." And originally, that's what happened. Adam and Eve loved God and had unbroken fellowship with him. They not only lived in a perfect world, but fellowship with their creator. Well, we know what happened, and God has given us free will. So we can love God or we can reject God. We can seek to know God's will or live our lives selfishly. We can ask for forgiveness or continue to seek our own desires. The psalmist in today's reading said, "If you kept a record of our sins, who could escape being condemned? But you forgive us, stand in awe of you." Isn't that amazing? God still loves us unconditionally and still bothers with us. The psalmist says, "Trust in the Lord because his love is constant and he's always willing to save." God didn't want programmed automated robots. He wants us to choose God and faith and love. He wants us to bother with God just as God us. We are in a covenant with God, in a relationship. Noah, Abraham, Moses, David, covenants, but through Jesus Christ, we have a new covenant with God. And that's the promise that God has made with humankind, that he will forgive sin, he will restore our relationship with those of us who believe in Jesus Christ. Jesus is the mediator, and he defeated death by his resurrection, and he restored life for all of us who believe in him. God still loves us, and he yearns for us to know him and love him and have fellowship with him. And he made this possible, of course, through Jesus Christ. But why does God bother? My answer is, it's an unconditional, eternal, everlasting love that goes beyond our human capability to completely understand. Let me say that again. God bothers with us because of God's unconditional, eternal, everlasting love that goes beyond our human capability to completely understand. That precious little girl, Jairus' daughter, somehow heard the voice of Jesus, recognized that voice, and rose from her bed. The woman who touched Jesus' garment had faith and courage and acceptance of that unconditional love and was healed. And she wasn't afraid to touch Jesus. We need that same courage out to Jesus, to reach out to God, to be open to the Holy Spirit. They won't be bothered by us because they will always bother with us. Have you ever wondered if you should really pray about something? Sometimes you think, oh, maybe it's not important enough. Maybe God's got other things to do. Maybe I shouldn't lift this up to God right now. A few weeks ago, our youngest granddaughter asked me to alter her prom dress. It was 5 layers of satin and tulle netting. It was the first time I ever prayed about sewing. But I prayed, let me tell you. Maybe I shouldn't have bothered God with praying about hemming a prom dress, all 5 layers, okay? But God doesn't mind that. God is there for us. He will bother with us. Jesus will bother with us. You know the hymn, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus"? We know that so well. And some of the lines say, "What peace we often, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer." And we take it to God in prayer. You see, it's no bother to God or Jesus or the Holy Spirit when we pray. In fact, Romans 8:26 says, "In the same way the Spirit comes to help us, weak as we are, for we don't know what we ought to pray, but the Spirit pleads with God for us." No bother. Even when we do not have the right words, that doesn't bother God. In fact, Jesus even asked the perfect prayer, the Lord's Prayer. No bother there. Just like the woman who touched Jesus' robe and Jairus' daughter who heard his voice from the grave, we need to be open to Jesus. We need to take time to contemplate all that God has done for us in our lives. How much has God bothered with us? No matter how undeserving we may think we are, or that we shouldn't bother God. Jonas is going to sing, thank you, a beautiful worship song called "The Goodness of God." And as he sings it, I want you here in church, at home, in the hospital, in care homes, I want you, if you want, close your eyes, and I want you to think of the many times good to you, that God has bothered with you. Perhaps God comforted you and gave you peace when a loved one died. Perhaps God gave you strength and courage to deal with a challenging situation. Perhaps, like the woman who touched Jesus, you felt alone, but God was with you and supported you. And perhaps, like Jairus' daughter, you were in a very dark place, but you could hear the voice of Jesus saying, "Arise, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Listen now and remember the goodness of God.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able,
of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, so faithful, Lord, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Amen. That is the goodness of God. God bothers with us and is not bothered by us. We are called by Jesus to bother with others, to care for others, to love others. Jesus challenges us in Mark 10 to feed the hungry, give water to the thirsty, show hospitality to strangers, clothe the naked, visit the sick and imprisoned. We have been touched by Jesus with love and forgiven, and reach out and touch others with that same love. This week is the 4th of July. That the founders of our nations bothered to be upset by unfair taxation. That they bothered to declare the rights that all people should have, that they bothered to risk their lives reading the Declaration of Independence and signing their name. And that blessing of a free nation under God comes with our responsibilities to bother to vote and be informed. We need to continue to use our rights and privileges and blessings to serve God and live godly lives in a country that allows us to do that. Remember the grocery store that I told you about? That had many items in her cart, and I was really bothered by her. After she finished paying, she turned to me with tears in her eyes. And she said, "Thank you for not saying anything. You see, my baby is homesick and my mother is watching him. I'm home as fast as I can with his prescription and Pedialyte and the popsicles the doctor said he needed. I don't know when I'm going to get back again to pick up any more groceries. Thank you." I smiled at her, placed my hand on her arm, and said, "No bother. I will pray for your son and for you." And I did pray for them. And I also prayed for myself, asking God's forgiveness for my selfishness and love and compassion. Winnie the Pooh says, "Oh, bother," when he's upset. But if we can model our lives after Jesus, when we accept the grace and mercy and love of God who has followed us all our lives, and when we allow the Holy Spirit to direct our thoughts and actions,